You may defeat us, but you will never defeat our poverty. This is a famous quote, true life quote, from Alexander's invasion of the Afghan kingdoms in around 330 BC. And I'm going to talk today more as a writer than as a historian. And I want to talk about Alexander's campaign in Afghanistan. I wrote two books about Alexander. The second one was called The Afghan Campaign, and that's what it was about. This was the sternest fighting and really the only campaign that Alexander ever participated in that he didn't just win outright. And there's a famous story, getting back to that quote, that when Alexander's army was about to invade the Afghan kingdoms, he was invited by a delegation of tribal leaders in what in those days they called the Wild Lands, but today is Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Kazakhstan, those areas around there. And they met out on a windswept steppe in tents, and the tribal leaders begged Alexander not to invade their country. And they said this to him for his own sake. And that was when they said, "You may defeat us, but you will never defeat our poverty." And what we're talking about here is the most primitive form of the warrior archetype, the tribesman. Now, Pashtunistan is the area, even today, between Pakistan and Afghanistan, that is, I think it's a 48 million population of Pashtun tribesmen of various styles and various formats. And their honor code, Pashtunwali, is known very, very well by any of our soldiers or Russian soldiers or British soldiers or anybody that's been in Afghanistan and got their ass kicked and had to come out. And the codes of honor, the Pashtunwali codes of honor, are typical of tribal codes of honor all over the world, including Native Americans, Cheyenne, Sioux, Crow, so forth. And they really derive from the primitive hunting band, and they are also the virtues. Tribal virtues are really warrior virtues. Think about hatred of all outsiders, respect for elders, obedience to elders, courage, patience over centuries, but most of all, the ability to endure suffering and privation on a level that's so extreme that no enemy can stand up to it. And that's what the tribal leaders meant when they said, "You may defeat us, but you'll never defeat our poverty." And if you compare this to, say, fighting a modern enemy, like American forces fighting against Nazi Germany or against Japan, Imperial Japan, in modern civilizations, you have things like cities and bridges and oil refineries and places that are strategic, and that if you can destroy them through bombing or whatever, you can break the will of the enemy to fight. But in a primitive country like Afghanistan, like the Afghan kingdoms where Alexander was, there are no cities and there are none of these things. And so the enemy is living at such a subsistence level that if he is willing to endure that, then it puts an incredible strain on any kind of modern army, which is what Alexander was, to endure that and to keep fighting. What happened with Alexander was that his army was reduced to the same level as the enemy that he was fighting against. And he initiated a campaign of massacres. He depopulated entire regions, just moved everybody out, just cleaned the place to bare bones in an attempt to match the brutality of his enemy and the enemy's capacity for suffering and make them crack. But of course they didn't. So what happens in a case like that is that the primitive enemy defeats the more civilized enemy because they defeat the enemy morally. An army like Alexander's or like ours or the Russians or anyone just couldn't endure that on a moral or an ethical level. If you think about our guys, did we really win after what we did in Abu Ghraib? So it cracked the will to endure. As they used to say, as the enemies would say, the Taliban would say, fighting us in Afghanistan, "You guys have the watches, but we've got the time." So how did Alexander finally win in Afghanistan? How did he get out of there? And the answer is he didn't win. He finally made a deal after 3 years of the hardest campaign he ever had. He made a show of marrying the daughter, Roxanne, of his greatest tribal enemy, Oxiartes, and basically he turned over the country. to Oxiartes, a warlord, in trade for them allowing the supply lines to stay open so that Alexander could move on into India. So in other words, he basically declared victory and got the hell out of there. So what does this mean to us in our own inner war when we're kind of summoning our warrior virtues against an implacable inner enemy? And the answer is that will, sometimes just the desire to victory, is simply not enough. We have to come to some other means of getting around the enemies inside ourselves.